Hey, good morning. Welcome. You guys are the diehards. Good job. Welcome. We're glad that you made it and that you're here with us, or maybe you're watching online this morning, and we're glad that you're joining us too. We just want to, again, welcome you, and we're going to start our service this morning with some singing together. So if you'd like to stand, feel free to do that and stand with us as we start.
Words of life.
God, we thank you that we can come to you, God, in our weakness, in our longings and desires, Lord. We can bring those to you, God. We can enter into your presence, into your rest. Thank you for the blood of Jesus that makes us whole and forgiven and right in your eyes, Lord God. We thank you for this opportunity to come together, whether it's in person or online. Lord, I pray that your spirit would speak to us, God, and that your will would be done. In Jesus' name, amen. You can have a seat and go.
In the Alliance, we're not just a group of nice people. We're not just a group with an interesting history. We're neither a historical monument or just a missions movement. We're not that stuff. The Alliance family is really just a bunch of people simply who are amazed at the birth, life, death, resurrection, ascension, and mission of Jesus Christ. We are simply Jesus people. It is this simplicity of Jesus that allows us to stay focused on why we're here and what we're doing. If we ever lose our focus on Jesus in his fullness, in his life of healing and setting people free from demonic oppression and releasing kingdom power and seeing people who are marginalized in the community, if we ever lose focus on Jesus' death and the provision that we have of salvation from his cross, then at the very best, we're going to be like a nice little club that tries to add people. And at the very least, we will walk away from him and he will turn us over to ourselves and we will miss what he has for us. This is all about Jesus.
Well, good morning. Good morning. Y'all find a seat okay? Just kidding. Thanks for coming. We do need to be praying for our youth that are in Minnesota on their way back. I don't know. Anybody have an idea how widespread this storm is? Curious. Anyway, you need to pray that they have safe travel back. Just a couple announcements. The first one is Friends of Reynolds. If you shop there and put our church code for when you check out, we get like a percentage back, and then that money is given to different organizations. We've given to the Bible Camp. We've given to Sunrise Women's Clinic. We've given to different missionaries. Anyway, every quarter then we'll get a check from Reynolds, so I'm not going to go through that. It's in your bulletin. Every time you shop there, you have the potential to basically give back to us, and we give it back to whomever the Lord lays on our heart to give to. So great way to bring in a few extra dollars. And for those of you that do the grocery shopping, it's quite a bit of extra dollars because everything here is expensive. Anyway, it helps. So just make yourself aware of that. And this coming week, we're going to have Kaylin and Britta Thrain with us. Kaylin and Britta have been serving in Gabon, Africa, and they are transitioning to serve in Senegal, Africa. So Gabon is more central Africa, Senegal is more western. Anyway, we have them here for a week. Dennis, can you get one of these down each aisle, please? We are having a meal with them on Wednesday. Thank you. And we need a sign up so we know how many meals to prepare for that. So if you're interested and available to come Wednesday night, I lost the time. 6 o'clock here at the church. And then we'll be able to hear from them. Plus, we have all the other events going on. They'll be sharing with us next. You know what I'm saying, all this? Lord willing, they'll be here. Anyway, look forward to hearing from them, Kaylin and Britta. Nice young couple, young family with their kids. So make note of that and come as often as you can to hear from them. We'd like to also bless our community, and this week we are going to lift up the Sydney Middle School. I don't know if you've been here the last couple weeks. There's kind of a theme developing. We're praying for the schools, the teachers, the staff, the students. I know none of the kids are looking forward to summer break yet, but I know the teachers are. So we just want to pray God's blessing and anointing over them, and that they can learn what they need to learn, and for the teachers to have the strength and the wisdom. It's, to me it's one of the highest callings that gets the least amount of recognition and support. So we're going to pray for the staff, teachers, students at Sydney Middle School. So with that said, let's bow our heads and pray together. Father God, we are grateful to be here today and to be able to do what we're doing is not to be taken for granted. We thank you for the freedoms that we have in this country to gather publicly like this. I would pray for our church family around the world, brothers and sisters in Christ, that don't necessarily have the freedoms we do. And they go through a whole lot more even just to meet for a couple people, let alone in public like this. So strengthen the body of Christ, I pray, around the world. I pray for your blessing on the youth and the leaders that are making their way back from Minnesota. I pray that this storm is not going to cause any delay for them, that the roads can be clear by the time they make it back this way. And just, again, I pray, God, that you would speak to each and every one, the students and the adult volunteers, God, that even as they travel, you can use that as a time to minister to them and to one another. And Lord, we also want to lift up the Sydney Middle School. I pray for the teachers to have the grace, the strength, the wisdom that they need to minister and to teach these kids what they need to know. I pray for extra patience for all of them, knowing that they are winding down the year, but there's a lot of hurting units, and I pray, God, for an extra measure of grace to be upon all that attend and take part in the Sydney Middle School. I pray that your will can be done there as it is in heaven. Father God, we're inviting your spirit to come for the rest of this service. I pray that we can be of one heart and of one mind and one spirit. We'll worship you and we'll serve you as best as we can. We ask and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, we're going to continue in worshiping the Lord together through singing, but I wanted to read a scripture that I feel goes along with this next song. It's from Romans chapter 1, verses 11, and going on from there. I long to see you so that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to make you strong. That is, that you and I may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. And Paul is writing that to the Romans. And I just was thinking about that as I was preparing this song this past week, and just how so often we can feel alone or we can feel discouraged. And we call out to the Lord, but we forget that we have the body of Christ also to join with in prayer. And just the power of calling out to our brothers and sisters in Christ and asking them to join with us in prayer. And as we do that, we're giving each other encouragement. We're giving each other Jesus in the flesh. And how many of us are just lacking that encouragement? We're lacking that joy. And it's a struggle, daily struggles. But I want to encourage you to not only call out to Jesus, but to call out to each other and to be there for each other.
Give me Jesus.
If you'd like to stand this morning, just feel free to do that, and we can worship standing or sitting. Jesus, that you have come for us, that you came to seek and save the lost. Thank you, Lord, that you are King over all, sovereign and holy. Lord, we worship you. Lord, thank you that we can come to you, God. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. You can have a seat.
All right, next couple weeks, barring next week, we're going to have Kaylin Britisher with us, but this Sunday, then the following two Sundays after that, I'm going to be taking a look at the Gospels, or as the Gospels presented to us in the Old Testament. And believe it or not, there is enough scripture, there are enough prophecies in the Old Testament for the Apostle Paul to present the Gospel to the people that he was writing to in Rome before they had the New Testament like we have today, all right? So you got to remember that the Apostle Paul is writing to the Romans roughly 50 years after the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and at that time the church did not have like the Bible that many of you are holding in your hands today, the Old and the New Testament. What they had at that time was the Old Testament. We are blessed to have not only the Old Testament, but then the New, which we have all the prophecies of Jesus, we see them fulfilled. And by the time that Paul is writing the book of Romans, he was not necessarily a witness to all that, but he was well aware of what Christ had done. So next couple weeks, we're going to be taking a look at the gospel in the Old Testament. This week, the birth, regarding the birth of Christ. Then in 2 weeks, the life and ministry of Christ. How do we see that prophesied and then fulfilled in the New Testament? And then in 3 weeks, we'll be looking at the death and resurrection of Christ, how that's prophesied in the Old Testament, and how we then can see it fulfilled in the New. I hope we can see in these coming weeks, today, starting today, that the gospel is presented to us in the Old Testament. And knowing we have the benefit of seeing it fulfilled in the New, we can for sure have confidence that what we are reading, Old and New Testament, is the Word of God. It is exactly as He said it would be. And we're just so blessed to have both Old and New Testament available to us. So I'm going to ask you to bow your head and pray with me, and then we're going to be looking at Romans chapter 1. So, Father God, again, we are blessed to have your word available to us, and we know it's not just written down by men, that these were inspired words by you. Your Holy Spirit came upon these men to write what they did, to prophesy what they prophesied, and now we have the benefit of looking back and seeing old and new and how it's prophesied, fulfilled. You are a trustworthy, a faithful God, and we can place our faith and trust in you with absolute confidence. Guide us now. This time we pray as we look at these verses from your word. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So if you want to open your Bibles to Romans chapter 1, I'm going to be reading verses 1 through 7. And this is from the New International Version. So if you have a different version, a word here or there may be different, but we're reading the same Bible, right? Some different wording here and there. Romans chapter 1, beginning of verse 1. It says, Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures regarding his son, who as to his human nature was a descendant of David, and who through the spirit of holiness was declared with power to be the son of God by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him and for his name's sake, we received grace and apostleship to call people from among all the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith. And you also are among those who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord, and from the Lord Jesus Christ. So a couple questions I'm asking as I read this is, we have to have the foundation of what is the gospel, right? Paul says, I'm sharing with you the gospel which he promised beforehand through his holy prophets. Okay, I know many of you have been in church for like a good part of your life. I don't want to miss, if somebody doesn't know what the gospel is, this is it real simply, right? That we are saved by God's grace. It's not by our effort. It's not by cleaning up our life. It's not by quitting whatever, starting whatever. It's by the grace of God. Ephesians 2, 8, 9. It's by grace you are saved through faith. And this is not of yourselves. It's a gift from God. Okay, it's available to all of us. The gospel is that we are saved from God's righteous wrath. And I don't know if we fully appreciate and understand that, right, we've all sinned. There's not a one of us that has measured up to God's standard. And the punishment, the righteous, just punishment for all our sin is an eternity separated from Christ in hell. It is by God's grace that we are saved from this wrath, that we are saved from an eternity in hell. And Ephesians 2, 3 to 5 says, like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by his grace that you have been saved. Again, saved by his grace, we're saved from his wrath. And lastly, I think what we tend to sell short in the evangelical church is that we are also saved for a purpose. We are saved for the good works that God has prepared in advance for us to do, and we get that in Ephesians 2:10. We all want to grasp onto 8 and 9. We're saved by grace through faith, not by works. Good. Hang on to that. But I want to encourage you also to hang on to verse 10, that God has already prepared good works for us to do, and he wants us to walk in that. He wants us to live in that. If you didn't hear my sermon from last week, I'd encourage you either go to our Facebook page or our church website to take a listen to that. Because last week we were looking at this same passage of Scripture in that we are called. That we are called by God, right? To call others to the faith in Jesus Christ. We are called to belong to Jesus Christ. We are called to be saints. Okay, there's a lot that we are called to. And he's calling us to be those messengers, those ambassadors, communicating, sharing the gospel with others, okay? So we're not just saved from, we are, but we are also saved for. Okay, that's the gospel in a nutshell. Paul's saying, I'm going to preach that to you, and I'm going to preach it to you from the Old Testament. If you'd look back again in Romans chapter 1, I'm going to read verses 1 through 4 again, and this is the what we're going to be basing the sermons on for the next couple weeks. Again, Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God. Okay, listen to this. The gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures regarding his son, who as to his human nature was a descendant of David. We're going to drill down on that a bunch today. And who through the Spirit of holiness was declared with power to be the Son of God by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. My question is, and I've had this question for years, and maybe it's a question of yours, how in the world could Paul present the gospel concerning Jesus Christ? How could he present the gospel from the Old Testament? Anybody else ask that question? Nobody? I'm really feeling alone up here. Paul had enough information from the Old Testament. What do we tend to do? We tend to look at the New Testament solely. Paul had enough information from the Old Testament to present the gospel to the people living in Rome and beyond. We are blessed to not only have the Old Testament, we have the advantage of seeing those prophecies being fulfilled in the New Testament. So, what I want you to understand is that we have been given a solid foundation of the gospel throughout the whole Bible, Old Testament and New Testament. That thread is all the way through there, right? What then does Paul teach? See, OT means Old Testament, not overtime. What does the Old Testament teach about the gospel concerning Jesus Christ, our Lord? I really would encourage you to take notes if you're not, because I'm going to go through a lot of scripture, right? We're going to look at the Old Testament prophecy, and then we're going to see where it's fulfilled. So this morning we're talking about the Old Testament prophecies concerning, again, this week, the birth of Jesus, in 2 weeks, the life and ministry, and then in 3 weeks, the death and resurrection of Christ. So, the birth of Jesus Christ. There is a prophecy back in the book of Genesis, believe it or not, that Jesus Christ would be born of a woman, right? We have the setting in the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve have sinned. God is now calling them to account, Adam and Eve, as well as the serpent, which we, pretty sure it's Satan, right? He came in and tempted Adam and Eve to eat of the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. They did, and now God is coming to them, and he's saying, look, and this is specifically to the serpent, to Satan. He says, and I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. Okay, God is telling us in Genesis already, first book that we have in the Bible, that there is going to come a Savior from the seed of Eve. In other words, it's not going to be some alien coming down, right? It's not going to be somebody that we don't know where he has his beginning from. It is going to come down through a woman. In other words, we can know that Jesus Christ, our Lord, the Messiah, is going to be, key word here, a human, a man, right? And where do we see this fulfilled? In the New Testament, go to Matthew 1, verse 18. Excuse me. This is how, don't miss these words, this is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. We continue to read that verse. John 1:1 and 1:14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. In other words, Jesus Christ always has been. Why? Because Jesus Christ is God in the flesh, right? In that sense, God, Jesus Christ did not have a beginning. Why? Because God didn't have a beginning. He was with God in the beginning. Verse 14, the Word became flesh. Here's Jesus coming to us as a man, as a baby, as a boy. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Okay? Old Testament prophecy, a seed from Eve is going to come. New Testament, we're seeing in Matthew 1, John 1, Galatians 4:4-5. When the time had fully come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under law, to redeem those under law, that we might receive the full rights of sons. Okay? So Paul is able to use scripture from the Old Testament to set this up already, that we're going to know that when Jesus Christ, the Messiah, comes, he's going to be born. He's going to be from a woman, right? Not some whatever weird thing that we know we'll be able to trace back his lineage, his human lineage. And check this out. The next prophecy is we're going to be able to trace it all the way back that he'd be a descendant of David. We're talking King David. Okay. So I'll say this later. Of any one of these prophecies, the odds of any one of these prophecies, any one of these prophecies coming fulfilled, let alone all of them, okay, it's a God thing. Second prophecy then is that Jesus would be a descendant of King David. We have it fulfilled, or the prophecy, Isaiah 9:7. And again, you got to remember all these prophecies that we're looking at this morning, they are written hundreds and hundreds of years before Jesus Christ ever came into existence as a human, okay? Hundreds of years. Isaiah writes, of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. A couple chapters later, Isaiah 11. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. Any idea who David's father is? Jesse. Very good. You paid attention in Sunday school. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots, a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of power, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord. Okay? A couple prophecies saying it's Jesus is going to be a descendant of David. Where do we see this fulfilled? Then in Matthew 1:17, there were 14 generations from Abraham to David, 14 generations from David to the exile, to Babylon, and then 14 generations from the exile to Christ. We're going all the way back, tracing the human lineage of Jesus back to David. We also have Matthew 12:23. This is fascinating to me. Again, jot this down, take a look at it later. They brought him, Jesus, a demon-possessed man who is blind and mute, and Jesus healed him so that he could both talk and see. All the people were astonished and said, "Can this be the son of David?" Okay. They had enough knowledge of the Old Testament scripture to know that the Messiah, the Lord, when he comes, would be doing this type of stuff. And here Jesus performs a miracle, and immediately they're looking back, probably to this prophecy from Isaiah. Is this the son of David? Is this who we've been waiting for? Matthew 1:4, another fulfillment. That he's the son of David. It says a record of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. See? So, prophecy fulfillment. He's going to be born of a woman. He's going to be a descendant of David. Third prophecy is, and now we're kind of getting like, boy, if these don't come true exactly, this is just a bunch of, like, baloney, right? Prophesied that Jesus would be born in Bethlehem. Micah 2:5, Micah, another prophet. "But you, Bethlehem, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come one for me, one who will rule, be the ruler of, over Israel, whose origins are from old, from ancient times." In other words, Jesus goes back before even his birth. Obviously, then we see this fulfilled in Matthew 2. 1-5, I just got the one verse up there. "After Jesus was born in Bethlehem, in Judea, during the time of King Herod, magi from the east came to visit him." So you're seeing prophecy, you're seeing fulfillment. Even more amazing is the prophecy from the Old Testament that Jesus Christ would be born of a virgin. Just for your information, this doesn't happen. Like, it doesn't happen. But when God's in it, it does happen. The virgin birth, Isaiah 7:13 and 14, says, "The Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel." Where do we see this fulfilled in the New Testament? Can you advance it a slide, Trace? It's not going. In Matthew 1:18, "This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit." We go back to Luke chapter 1, verses 34 and 35. Again, seeing the fulfillment of the virgin birth of Christ. The angel's talking to Mary, telling her she's going to carry Jesus Christ. She'll be the mother of Jesus. She asks, "How can this be?" Mary asks the angel, "Since I am still a virgin." The angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the one to be born will be called the Son of God." Starting to get the picture how Paul could preach the gospel concerning Jesus Christ from the Old Testament. I've got a couple more for you. See if we get this. Prophecy is that Jesus Christ would be called Emmanuel, right? Again, we look at this, or we get this prophecy from Isaiah chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. "The Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and we'll call him Emmanuel." Where do we see it fulfilled in the New Testament? Matthew 1:23. "The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. I hope you're not just sitting there saying, yeah, ho-hum, I heard this all before, this is good. It is good. But do you understand how Paul is able to preach the gospel concerning Jesus Christ from the Old Testament? They did not have the New Testament. They didn't have the Bible as we have it today. A couple more. Jesus Christ would be worshipped and given gifts. Psalm 72:10 says that the kings of Tarshish and of distant shores will bring tribute to him. The kings of Sheba and Seba will present him gifts. Okay? I don't know this. Somebody must. But Matthew 2:1-11, we have, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi, or we know them as wise men, came from the east. I can only presume that from the east means of Tarshish and distant shores, from Seba, that area. Wise men came from the east to Jerusalem, verse 11, on coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother, and they bowed down, and they worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and incense and myrrh. Are you kidding me? Like, exactly how it was prophesied. Two more. Prophecy that Joseph would be warned in a dream to take the child away and go to Egypt, right? Prophecy is Hosea 11:1. When Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. Fulfillment, Matthew chapter 2, verses 13 to 15. An angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. Get up, he said, take the child and his mother and escape to Egypt. Stay there until I tell you, for Herod is going to search for the child and kill him. So he got up, took the child and his mother during the night, and left for Egypt, where he stayed until the death of Herod, and so was fulfilled what the Lord had said through the prophet, out of Egypt I have called my son. One more prophecy, one more presentation of the gospel. I'm saying the foundation for the gospel from the Old Testament, which Paul is using to present the gospel to those in Rome. Last one then for this morning. King Herod would murder children in an attempt to kill Jesus. And the prophecy is from Jeremiah 11:15. A voice is heard in Ramah, weeping in great mourning. Rachel weeping for her children and refusing to be comforted because they are no more. See this fulfilled in Matthew 2:16, when Herod realized that he had been outwitted by the Magi, he was furious and he gave orders to kill all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity who were 2 years old and under. You can't make this up. There's no way, and you got to understand, there are hundreds of years separating the prophecy from the fulfillment. I hope you see and hear that we have a God that we can believe in, we can trust in. He is faithful to his word. This, please, don't buy the lie that the Bible is just another book written by men. It's not. This is the living word of God inspired by him, given to us to instruct us in how we can be in right relationship with him and how we can live in a way that honors and obeys him. Check this out. There's a book, I haven't read it, sounds fascinating. Peter Stoner wrote a book, Science Speaks, okay? And in this book, I'm quoting from him, he calculated the chance of any man fulfilling these prophecies even down to the present time. In other words, even if we had another 2,000 years, for any one man to fulfill these prophecies to be 100 quadrillion, 1 in 100 quadrillion, that's 10 to the 17th power. You're talking to the guy who doesn't know numbers. That's a lot of numbers, a lot of zeros. how anyone can think that Jesus just happened to be in the right place at the right time, it's no coincidence. I have one more, I hope. Can you advance it, Trace? To help us visually comprehend the staggering odds of this probability, Stoner proposed that we take that many silver dollars, 100 quadrillion, and lay them across the state of Texas. In doing so, we'd find that they would stack up across the state 2 feet deep. Yeah, Texas. His quote, but wait, there's more. Now we would have to mark one of those silver dollars, stir up the entire mass of coins, then blindfold a volunteer and tell him that he can travel as far as he likes across the state of Texas, but that he must pick the one coin, the one marked silver dollar. That is how difficult it would be for a single man to fulfill the 300 plus prophecies. This author, Stoner, then upped the ante significantly. He said he found that the odds of any man fulfilling even 48 of the 300-plus Old Testament prophecies jumped to 10 to the 157th power. Okay, we got a lot more zeros. I want you to see and appreciate and have faith in what is being presented to us in the Old Testament, the gospel being presented to us hundreds of years before Jesus came, is trustworthy. We can know that we can know without a doubt that we have a consistent message all the way back from Genesis concerning the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Paul was confident. If we see anything as we make our way through the book of Romans, we're going to see that Paul was confident that he is preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ according to what he had given to him from the Old Testament. We have the added benefit of seeing and hearing and knowing the Old Testament prophecies being fulfilled in the New Testament, right? We're at an advantage to what he had. My question to you this morning is, Have you put your trust in Jesus Christ? He is trustworthy. He is faithful. And if you haven't, I would invite you to do so today, to confess with your mouth that Jesus is your Lord, to believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, right? Commit, surrender your life to him, everything that you have, everything that you are, give it to him. Let him be your Lord. Let him be your master. Let him be the one controlling, directing, guiding your life. You submit to him. We do this by faith, trusting that Jesus Christ is who he said he is, that there's no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved, and that you, by faith, by the grace of God, are calling out to him to save you from your sins, to save you from that eternity in hell, to equip and empower you to do those good works which he has prepared for you to do. That's believing in Jesus. If you haven't done that, I would highly encourage and invite you to do so today. And if you have already done so, my prayer is that this look at just even a handful of scripture prophecies fulfillment would encourage you in your faith, bolster you. We are believing the truth. There's no way this is a coincidence. Let us then, as Paul says later in chapter 1 of Romans, let us be unashamed to testify about the gospel of God. For it is the power of God to save all, right? That's for us. That's for everyone. You bow and pray with me. Father God, we are more than blessed to have not only the Old Testament prophecies, but we get to see them fulfilled in the new, and now we're a couple hundred years past that, and we know that you are trustworthy. We know that you are faithful. We know that you have a plan, that you have a purpose for each and every one of us. And Lord, we know that it is your will that none would perish, but that all would repent and come to a knowledge of the truth. Dear God, we are praying for any who have yet to commit their life to Christ, that today would be the day. And for those of us that have already done this, may this bolster our faith in your confidence. Would you enable and empower us then to communicate the gospel well to the people that you bring into our lives this week? We want to represent you well. We want to see others coming into the kingdom, trusting Jesus Christ as their Savior. And we ask and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, so again, reminder, this week we're having Kaylin and Britta Thrain with us. Lord willing, they get here. Starting Tuesday night, Wednesday we got the meal. Next Sunday they'll be sharing with us. Just a little FYI there, we're going to be taking a love offering for them, so if you can be just prepared for that next week, we want to bless them, as I'm sure they're going to be blessing us throughout the week. Shortly after the service here, we have a life group that meets up here for the adults. Are you going to have the ladies? Oh, that kind of looked like no. Oh, okay, that's like no. This is, ladies will be downstairs in Pastor Harry's office. I don't know if we even have any youth here today. No going deeper? Okay, thank you. No going deeper. You can sit with the adults. We'll take you. And then the kids are downstairs. So if you'll stand up, please, and receive the benediction. I pray the Lord will bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Have a blessed week. Thank you.